to you, which I was lucky and I was accepted by Norway, and I've lived there for 18 years. Always where you are grown up, you always feel homesick. I chose to wait in Norway until things could calm down and that I can come back and participate, because it is history in the making. I've had a very beautiful and happy childhood, as any other Somali kid in my generation. Life was simple, very enjoyable, free, and we had the choices to be what we want. Before I left the country, I served in many offices. I started my career as a teacher back in 1962, and from there I went to work in the labor department, where I became director of labor, vice minister, member of the parliament, and then I became the Ministry of Labor and Social Affairs, and then I became the Minister of Air and Land Transport in Somalia latest.
My brother Mohamed Osman Jawari, I know him since early 70s, when I was also a student that time. Mr. Jawari, first of all, he's a man of vision. He's not a person, he's an institution, walking institution.
Yeah, the memory I have about my father as a politician, I think the best word to describe him is a civil servant. I think that describes him better than a politician. He was a civil servant first. He studied law in Italy, so he was one of the people who took over the service of those countries after they got their independence. So you have to see him in that context. So they were trained, well-educated, they were prepared to take over the running day-to-day of a country.
The time that Somalia was very vigorous. It was building, it was developing, it was going ahead, looking forward, working day and night. What we could do ourselves, we used to do it with no hesitation. Sometimes we were failing, but we were learning and we were going ahead. So life was very democratic. You could say what you want, express your opinion, and in fact, understanding of democratic rights that you have and democratic duties you have. That's what makes life easier.
He saw what it is to have a country, a functioning country, what it can do for you and what you can do for a country, right? Which is one of the things we've lost right now today, is almost the opposite, where kids might not know what the function of a government is. What does a government do for you? What does it do? They haven't seen anything like that for 20 years. But in his generation, if you look at them, they have seen a functioning government, a functioning, free education, free health care.
You feel home. Wherever you go, you feel home. Children were enjoying a very, very good time, playing sport, going to school. Everybody was your parent. Every man around could hit you and say, okay, don't do that and do this.
Yeah, my childhood in Somalia was some of my best memories. Growing up, it was carefree, school, friends, soccer. The son of a cabinet minister, I would say it was very fortunate to be. In our old culture, you could get by just with your name, your father's name. There's a lot of value in that. But he made sure that we were valued because of the work we did, not who you are. He said, it's better that you say, I have a donkey that's my own, than to say, oh, my father is this, my father is that, my father is that. Because none of these things are yours.
The rule I follow is that I try to be friends with my children, make them feel that they can talk their problem to you, and be very frank and honest with the kids is very important. I try to make them good Muslims. They have to be connected with the earth. They have duty for the country and respect to each other. They can make mistakes. They think that they can decide by themselves. They're full of energy. They make a lot of mistakes. You have to correct them. You educate them.
The only thing that he expected us to do was education. Finish your education, then we talk. Even his daughters, he would make sure that they educated themselves. That's a bit different from the traditional Somali father.
So if the mother is educated, she will be educating the children. So our mothers, our daughters must get the best education they can.
Sure that we had a culture that was connected to his roots. Every other weekend we would go to the beaches in the countryside. Distant relatives had farms there. At the same time, we were born and raised in the capital city. We knew both cultures, city life and, you know, the country life. So for example, when schools were closed, I used to be left with my great-grandmother in the countryside. I would stay with her for almost 2 months. So it kept us grounded. He always tried to keep us grounded. I found out later in life that it also prepared me for my survival as an immigrant. If you have a solid identity of who you are, what you are, where your values are, you can see what the new people's values and morals are, and where you stand, what you can adopt. Lucky in that sense that I left just a year before the civil war broke out.
That's when the central government collapsed and the problems started. Building something is difficult. Destroying is very easy. Behind the 1,000 people who are building, one destroyer is enough to destroy them. But imagine if there is a 1,000 who are destroying and there is one person who is building. The clan issue came back. That was the problem which caused the collapse of the state.
A lot of the things that happened, the worst experiences were related to me by my family. And I remember a month where almost every week my mom will call me and tell me, do you remember so-and-so, your friend? I said, yes, he died today. And then a week later, she would be calling. We can hear the gunshots over the phone. And she would tell me, do you remember so-and-so? Yes, your friend, yeah, he died too. So they had to travel from Mogadishu to escape from all the chaos to the countryside. Within that distance, they saw a lot of stuff. Some of the kids still have trauma from that time. The kids have a huge capacity of suppressing this stuff. And just a month ago, one of my young brothers, he told me to this day he has nightmares.
I never dreamed in my life to live outside of Somalia. But the collapse of the country and the chaos that started here compelled me. It was not a choice for me to go out of the country. It was a must. I was compelled to get out. The kids, in fact, some of them were already studying in the United States when the collapse happened, and some were in Canada. So my wife preferred to join the family, her children, which were in Canada. So now she became a Canadian.
He ended up in Norway and we in Canada because he didn't leave the country, Somalia, right away. Him and other guys tried to change the constitution in such a way that provinces would have more power. As you know, in Africa, the governments are centralized, so the power, everything is concentrated in the president's office. They made those changes with all the bullets flying at the same time. While he's doing all this, we were on our way to America and then from America into Canada.
Going to Norway was my choice. I looked into the map and I said, this is the country where I would like to be.
So during that time, it was difficult. My mom was raising, you know, 5 kids by herself as a single mom. Looking back now, it was difficult, but it was a kind of a blessing.
I had the opportunity to go to the United States, to Canada, where some of my family were living. But I chose there because there is something to learn in Norway. There's something to learn in these Scandinavian countries. I chose Norway because of its neutrality. I just wanted to pause my life and think back, did I do something wrong? And to have a break from politics, because politics is a very hard job.
He loves this place. Yeah, he loves the people. He loves the value and culture of the people. You don't hear them say what they don't mean, you know? And they do what they say.
He was talking about how they are humble, how they are respectful to the people. All the time they are thinking about how to improve the lives of the people.
He's a very complicated guy, but you can sum him up in a couple of ways. Hardworking. He has a high work ethic and loyalty. And he found those two values here in Norway. It's almost that they're born with that kind of value, raised with that kind of value. So it was a good click for him. When you first come to Norway, people might seem that they're cold because they're not talking to you or whatever. He said the whole time they're observing you, what kind of person you are. Once they become your friend, it's for life and it's loyal, and you have to earn the friendship, kind of, almost.
Have a lot of problem. You are somebody in your country and you migrate to organize a society like Norway, you will just become a number, a social security number. So you are not the son of so and so, or you are the well-known guy and something like that. You are no more. Hva heter du? Jeg heter so and so. Person nummer so and so. Funny. Full stop. You are only a human being. There is no other difference. Then you have to start working hard. But the opportunity to become whatever you want to be in Norway, it is there. You can become an MP if you want in a parliament. You can become whatever you want. You can become a driver if that's what you like. Education is there. Facilities are there. It is just that you have to work hard and prove yourself. But if you just sit down and do nothing, you will not make any progress. Integrated myself into the society and started teaching, and also I was working partially with a lawyer. Then afterwards I decided to make myself useful and do something with the people who came to Norway from Somalia or Latin America or from the Arab countries. So we started to think together and do something. Help those who were helpless, assist them to integrate into the society, make them understand that they have to give back something. You have a duty as a Muslim, as a human being, as a Somali, You have a duty to give back to the country that adopted you, and don't think that what you can do is a minor thing. Those minor things put together, it becomes a big thing. You are part of them. Be constructive, participate, be a good taxpayer and good citizen. Something which is normal in your country might not be normal there. So be careful of those things and try to respect their culture and respecting their history and the values they have.
The philosophy comes from the fact that if two communities are living side by side and they're not talking and there's no communication, something else fills that vacuum. Something not always a good thing, something that's negative.
So there are cultural baggage which clashes with the local culture. We look at them, put our head together and say, what can we do for this situation?
So his thinking was that if people are talking, that would go a long way, and it did.
That idea developed, and the conflict road, and the office which is responsible for this kind of conciliation, took up that idea, and it became part of the system in Norway now.
Javari ble veldig viktig her I Trondheim. Javaris ekspertise, hans integritet, var utrolig viktig, og vi hadde mange arenaer for dialog.
Og han var åpenbart en veldig sentral person for alle muslimer I Trondheim. Han var jo også veldig kjent blant alle somaliere, faktisk også I hele Norge. Og han var en veldig våken observatør. Han la veldig raskt merke til og festet seg ved hvordan det norske samfunnet fungerte.
He became a leader of a community. He established his own community programs within the community.
Han hadde selv vært med å etablere moskeen her. Det var ingen moské her da han kom til Trondheim I 1991.
Moskeen var en viktig arena, fordi at moskeen var et knutepunkt for innvandrerbefolkningen. Og vi fikk nær kontakt med ledelse I moskeen og medlemmer I moskeen.
Og Javari var fra begynnelsen av den drivende kraften fra moskeens side I disse samtalene. Jeg møtte Javari I tida like etter de tragiske hendelsene I Amerika I september 2001. Da var biskopen på besøk I moskeen.
We sensed that this 9/11 issue which happened in the United States might affect also Norway.
When that happened, other Muslim communities in the world had difficult time.
So we started a kind of a Muslim-Christian dialogue. We were appearing together, the bishop and myself, talking to the people.
Instead of stereotypes and negative things being thrown at each other, it was actually the opposite. It was more of a coming together. The Norwegian community here knew what the Muslims were about.
Og jeg tror Mohammad Javari var en drivende kraft til å få det til fra muslimenes side.
Så in fact we succeeded, it was a good job.
Da vi fikk høre at Javari skulle tilbake til Somalia, så var det noe som vi ikke ønsket.
Og så fikk han jo denne muligheten på et oppdrag på vegne av FN, som gjorde at han dro til Nairobi og skulle være med på et prosjekt som FN hadde knyttet til Somalia. Og derfra rullet det videre. Den situasjonen han nå I, at han ventet mer eller mindre tilbake til det somaliske samfunnet og ble valgt inn I parlamentet og ble valgt til dets speaker eller president.
Coming back from Norway, back to Somalia, going into politics and becoming the speaker of the country, that is a little bit unique.
I personally didn't want him to go. We were very afraid, but he told me if good people don't try to change things, then when will things change?
The thing that he told me is that the country needs us. If everyone goes back to Western countries, who's going to save Somalia?
It is not only me who came back. If you look into the parliament, for example, you will find MPs who came from all over the world. There must be some people who sacrifice and do it. If we don't do it, then who?
To the parliament. The parliament was just a place of nothing. All previous parliament has left nothing at all. We haven't inherited even a single paper. He started to reform the whole parliament.
You need institutions that guarantee the existence of the state. Because the people are yearning for government, yearning for system, they are yearning for law and order. So we have to do it.
Jawari has accumulated a lot of knowledge from Norway. He learned a lot of things from Norway. When he's doing something, he's always compared with other countries.
Since I took up the office of the Speaker of this Parliament, we have been working very democratically. We make arguments, counter-arguments, shouting. Shouting in Parliament is normal.
We come from a civil war. People used to shoot each other, people used to punch each other. So we're moving from an era of actually civil war into direction where we actually are shouting and talking to each other in a way that you really feel you are very angry. But I really think we can move and we can do better, but we have a long way to go.
At the end of the day, we vote and the majority wins. And we proved that the Somali parliament can manage, that can solve political conflicts and disagreements.
I think without Jawari, everything will collapse. If he leaves tomorrow, this country, I'm sure that the whole thing will collapse.
I believe that what I have, my office is a trust. A trust from the people. That you are accountable to the people and you are accountable to God. Number two, humbleness is the power. You must understand and believe that you are the servant of the people. Not their king, not their boss. This kind of work, you become target of the enemy. Our MPs are being hunted. They are being killed on the road.
Even today, as we speak, about a few hours ago, an MP was killed. The day before we left Somalia, another MP was killed.
But why they are doing it? Because they understand that the parliament is the pillar of statehood. That's what they are fighting. We are 275. If they kill us all, 275 will come down.
Han gjør et arbeid nå i et land med veldig høy voldsaktivitet, og så har flere av parlamentsmedlemmene blitt drept I ulike voldshandlinger I Somalia. Så det klart, vi bærer jo også med oss en bekymring for hans sikkerhet.
The people's house is the voice of the people. So how can you be the voice of the people if you are not with the people?
Samtidig som det at han velger å gjøre det I en så konfliktfyllt sitt sammenheng jo også avkrever enda mer respekt.
There is no time to be afraid because as a leader you should show the courage that the work can be done. But fear?
He's a spiritual man. He said, listen, if my time comes, my time comes.
He worked with civil government in 1960s, with the military government in 1970s up to 1990s, and now he works with this environment.
If you want to do this kind of job, you have to be ready to be blamed. You have to be ready to be shot, but you have to have the courage of trying to help. Shabab, yes, it is very bad thing, but my view is that before they became Shabab, they were Somalis. We are receiving a lot of calls of young men that want to come back, but there is no apparatus, the mechanism that will accommodate them. So that's the whole problem.
We cannot defeat Shabab militarily only. To defeat Shabab, we need to win the hearts of the minds of Somali youth to make sure that we defeat the ideology of extremism.
It's very un-Somali, the culture on which they are doing self-explosion, suicide bombers, this kind of thing. So the vacuum of the state has been occupied by these people who have some other agenda. not Somali agenda, but a foreign agenda. And I believe that the only way to win Shabaab is dialogue. They cannot take over the government. They cannot be a government in this country. They know it, and everybody knows it. So it's very idiotic.
The only way he can solve it is with patience, intelligence, and wisdom. And he showed all that one.
People has the potentiality of becoming whatever it wants if they are given the chance. It needs courage. It needs consistency. It needs that you never lose the big picture in front of you. I see light. I see light, man. There's light everywhere. Light in the mind, light in the future. We are going ahead. We are normal. We are getting out from the darkness to the light.
When issues are very hot, you cannot stop with force. Jawari has shown a leadership as a statesman, a man of experience, a person who can at least give us an idea how we can move from here.
I think we can succeed. The potential is so great with these people. With few years of peace, they can start and fly. People think that we are chaotic. We are not. They have guns, they are killing each other, yes. But you need to address that good sense in the people. All the hope is in the people. We have to mobilize them, organize them, and demonstrate respect. Respecting each other. Somalia needs some of the serious patriotic Somalis to come back and help this country to stand up. I think everybody of my age has the duty to come back, because now is the time to help Somalia.